Hi everyone, shalom, blessed evening. I thank God for this opportunity to share the word of God with all of you. I want to thank Brother Davy for giving me this opportunity to share his word. Thank the leadership of FGB, the leadership council. Just want to encourage all of you, FGB, you are doing great. And don't forget, your DNA is always to be of the cutting edge. And that was the founder's DNA. So as part of the FGB, you carry that DNA to be always on the cutting edge, not just in the area of business, but in the move of the Holy Spirit, where there is no boundary of church or, you know, there's always this thought of church or not, but this is really where you are able to do and arrange programs such as this beyond churches and denomination. So may I encourage all who are actively serving in FGB to continue to pursue the Lord and allow Him to continue to birth the cutting edge ministry in your midst. God is good and He has a great plan for all of us. There's nothing for me to add where we are now in Malaysia and globally, what is going on. I always say that people are just waiting to get all this behind them. But if we are serious students of the Bible, we know of this thing called the birth pang. Birth pangs, if you know, I have three daughters, my wife has given birth to three daughters. So I've seen all the contraction. And so if we understand contraction, birth pangs increase in intensity and frequency before the actual birth. But in the Bible, brothers and sisters, it is not something foreign or strange to have times of darkness, times of uncertainty, times of hardship. We are all going through, in one form or another, hardship, the darkness. We are going through a time of pain that sometimes we do not know how to put into words. But the interesting thing is that in the Bible, we have countless numbers of examples where people of God have gone through all this and God has always come through and shined brightly through His people. Jesus Himself told His disciples, which include you and me, He said, be of good cheer. In this world, there will be many tribulations. Just in case you're not sure, it is in the New Testament and Jesus spoke to His disciple. But He said, be of good cheer, I have overcome the world. And throughout the Bible, we have examples of people of God who overcome through the darkest hour, times of pain, uncertainty, and hardship. Brothers and sisters, I'm very encouraged to see all of you gathering tonight. Why? Because it shows that you have a heart that is hungry for God, for the things of God. And hunger is a very important currency in the kingdom of God. We always like to say faith. Yes, faith is very important, no doubt about that. But hunger is a very powerful currency in the kingdom of God. And we are all here gathered tonight because we say we want to have a supernatural encounter with God. Hallelujah. When I see that photo just now of the Moses and the burning bush, it excites me because it speaks of an encounter. We are all here because we want to have an encounter with God. So what a blessed time we have worshiping God just now. That was really good. And brothers and sisters, just before we go further, let's just have a clear mind. Sometimes we think in this way. We think that coming and have a supernatural encounter is like having a lucky break. You know, we like to use these things, employ such things as a means to get something. I'm sorry, I'm someone who speaks things very direct, and this will help us as we look at the Bible and as we read the word and as we wait upon the Lord and let the Holy Spirit minister in our midst. May God speak to us and change our lives. Amen. So it's more than just encountering God for a lucky break so that I can get something out of this. What if an encounter with God actually amounts to encountering the heart of the Father? We should actually encounter His heart first. When we encounter His heart, we know him. And when we know him, we will always be under his care. Amen. Hallelujah. So one example of what I want to share with all of you. So I just pray that you will bear along with me. I'm sure if you pay attention, the Holy Spirit will speak to you here and there, and you will receive nuggets from the truth, from the Word of God. The Holy Spirit will bless you, will touch you. And if you wait until the very end, we'll pray together and we believe God will do a work and move in our midst. Amen. Hallelujah. So the example that I'm going to share with all of you tonight is about an encounter of a man in the Old Testament. His name is no other than Jabez. Jabez is not something that is not familiar to all of us. But we're going to see Jabez in a very different light this evening. What do I mean by a different light? We're going to see the prayer of Jabez in the year 2021. What does the prayer of Jabez mean in this year for you and for me? How does this position us, position you, position me to encounter God? When I was praying, when I was preparing this message, I was deeply impressed in my heart. I know that this word will align us, will align you and me, will position you and me. It's something very interesting that I read a couple of days ago. You know, there's this author who made a comparison. He said, why is it that God wants to pour out his goodness, his blessing, but not everyone receive it? Doesn't mean that God does not pour out, but it's that the person does not receive it. There will be some who receive, there will be some who don't. Let me show you something. In my hands here, if you can look at the screen, I have two glasses with me. If we imagine God pouring down his blessing, we should always be positioning ourselves in this manner. Amen. But sometimes we do not know. What if our lives are like this? And the flow of God's blessing will continue to be poured out. But only this glass will receive what God has poured out. Whereas these may still be praying, fasting, may still be doing what he thinks is correct, but he has not positioned himself to receive. So brothers and sisters, this is not a magic show, but we're going to look at the Word of God and let's see how God's Word can position ourselves. So we know the background of the prayer of Jabez. This has been made popular through a short book written by an author in the year 2000. It became a fashionable book to read. Everybody believed that it becomes like a lucky charm. You pray the prayer of Jabez, something miraculous will happen to you. But let's examine these two verses and see, is it true that it works as a lucky charm? Does it work like a mantra? Do I read this as a mantra and something will happen to my life? Let's look at the book of 1 Chronicles chapter 4. If you can look at the screen, I'm going to share the verses with you. 1 Chronicles chapter 4, verses 9 to 10. In the middle of telling about all the lineage here, it is recorded for us just in two verses. The author of 1 Chronicles just stopped and just mentioned these two verses about a prayer of a man named Jabez. If you have your Bible with you, or if you can read from the screen, let's read together. You don't have to unmute yourself. You can read. One, two, go. Now Jabez was more honorable than his brothers, and his mother called his name Jabez, saying, because I bore him in pain. And Jabez called on the God of Israel, saying, oh, that you would bless me indeed and enlarge my territory, that your hand would be with me, and that you would keep me from evil, that I may not cause pain. So God granted him what he requested. What is so wonderful about the prayer of Jabez is at the end of that prayer, we have this statement that God granted him what he requested. How all of us wish to have this kind of a promise. How we want to have this assurance. When I pray, God answer each and every of my requests. Hallelujah.
But does God work like a genie, like an Aladdin, you know, rub here and then give, what is your wish, my master? Name me your request and I will fulfill it. Does God work like this? If you have been a Christian, I'm sure you know that God is not a genie. God is the mighty creator of the heaven and earth. Amen. So in these two verses, what caught my attention was immediately the author described Jabez as something. What was it that was being described? Okay, what was the different thing that was mentioned about Jabez? Here we read that Jabez was more honorable. Have you ever thought, why was it that Jabez was more honorable? Before we go into some of the interesting things in his prayer, but this sets the tone and the foundation for us to understand what is the secret, the kingdom principles that you and I can learn tonight that will position ourselves to encounter God, to have a supernatural encounter that will give us breakthrough, increase, and to function in the destiny that God has for you and for me. Amen. The word honorable, many years ago, I did a seminar on the subject of honor. So when I read this word honorable, it caught my attention immediately because honor is a powerful word. Why do I say that? Honor in the original language, the Hebrew language, it is the same or similar word that is being used for glory. That we know glory in Hebrew is kabod, right? Kabod. In honor is kabod. It speaks, kabod or glory always speaks of something that is weighty or heavy. Glory is, the glory of God is heavy. Do you remember when they ministered before God, when the priest ministered before God, when the glory came, they could not stand up to minister. Why? The presence and the glory of God was so heavy upon them. So when the glory of God is manifested, sometimes it is like a heavy cloud that descends upon us. The manifested presence of God that descends upon us. But why is it that Jabez was more heavy? Do you think he's a fat man? No. But here we are told he was more honorable. Listen to me carefully, brothers and sisters. He was considered to be someone more weighty and heavier in his thought. He considered and he pondered over things in a deep way compared to his brothers. When we are going through pain, many people will say, hey, when will this pain end? When will they change the SOP? When can I cross this street or cross the state again? My brothers and sisters, have we ever taken the position to be a more honorable person? When we allow ourselves to be quiet and we let the Holy Spirit to think, and we think with the Holy Spirit, with the mind of Christ, we begin to ponder things in a deeper way. Have you ever thought, Jabez, his name means pain because the mother bore him and was in pain and said, "Aiyah, this child caused me much pain. I call him pain." So every name in a Hebrew culture means their character. You know, in Chinese, they also do that now, no more in the olden Chinese days. If you are Hokkien, you will know, right? I'm a Hokkien, I'm from Penang. So when they have a baby, he's fat, they call him Apui, right? They name him Apui. He's a fat boy. But nowadays, if you name like that, they cannot go to school. People will laugh at them. But this is what happened to Jabez. He was painful. He caused pain to his mother and he experienced pain himself. Every time he goes, people call him pain, pain, pain is here, pain is here, better run, pain is here, pain is here. But these things triggered something in Jabez. My brother, my sister, when we go through time of hardship, when we are in the middle of a pandemic, when we are in the middle of times of darkness, have you ever paused, Selah, and think deeply? Don't allow the world to tell you how to think. Don't allow the newspaper or whoever to tell you how to think. Have you ever pondered? Just pause and think and ask God, what is going on? What are you saying, Lord? We are bombarded with so many WhatsApp messages, so many social media messages every day. But to count ourselves as an honorable person, we should pause and be weighty, ponder deeply, consider the pain. Because when Jabez considered the pain, immediately, I believe, through the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, he was brought back to Genesis. When Adam and Eve fell into sin, what did God pronounce on Eve? In Genesis chapter 3, verse 16, God told Eve, I will greatly multiply your sorrow and your conception. In pain, you shall bring forth children. He must have thought long enough, deep enough, allowing the Holy Spirit to whisper in his heart. And he began to consider all these things that happen. People call me pain. I cause pain to other people. The uncertainty in life, the darkness, the hardship that I go through, there must be a reason. There must be an underlying cause. I must make sense of what's going on. That's why the author said he was more honorable than his brothers. His brethren would have gone through, just complain, no, must be the government, Pharaoh must be bad, they are not under Pharaoh, right? Whatever government, they are, just complain, because easy, you don't have to think. You are being fed what to think. Whatever you read, you think. Whatever people tell you, you're being led by the nose to think. But Jabez paused and he allowed the Holy Spirit to speak to him. He began to go back to how it all started. Pain was caused by sin. Nothing but sin. He did not need to blame his mother. He could have said, I'm born in this background. I'm born in this country. What if I was born in the White House? What if I was born in a different land? He could have blamed his mother. Why name me this name? Could have called me Abraham. I would have been a father of all nations. But why Jabez? He didn't settle down like everyone else and complain bitterly. He decided to ponder deeply, and that allowed God to speak to him. My brother and my sister, do you know there is a shift in the writing of the Apostle Paul after he began to experience suffering? Suffering and pain bring us deeper in our walk with God, cause us to think deeply about life. Pain, darkness, uncertainty, hardship, problem, difficulties, pressures in life, all these have a part to play in our lives. It reveals something to us. It reveals that the cause of pain is sin. But don't misunderstand me. I'm not asking you to be sin conscious. But brothers and sisters, if you and I possess a correct and a true understanding of sin, we will surely be led to discover God in a whole new way, to discover his love in a completely transformative way. More often than not, we just treat sin as just okay lah. You know, sin is bad and God, Jesus has come. Do you know that? Because of your sin, my sin, the Father allowed his only son to die a cruel death. It was not an easy passage. This is not a gospel. This is not just a good news. This is a message to every child of God to recall how great the redemption Jesus has given to us. It was not an easy thing. He died as a son of God, as a son of man. He died a cruel death. He could understand every pain that you go through. He could understand every shame that you go through. I remember when I was one time preaching in Indonesia, I was being brought to a school. All the children, they were all boys. They were all hardened. They were all noisy. But when I shared about the prodigal son, through the Holy Spirit, nothing to do with me, the love of God was revealed to them. At the end of the meeting, the Holy Spirit moved in our midst. Boys, students, crying, shedding tears, being delivered from the demonic things that control them. What was it? The love of God. The love of God. Without a proper understanding of sin, we will treat love, we will treat God as very cheap. We would take advantage of God. We would take advantage. And in fact, I'm sorry, once again, I'm telling you, I'm very direct because God has given me a prophetic voice as well. Brothers and sisters, the modern day church today uses the church, uses Christianity as a platform to get something. That is not Christianity. We are not to take advantage or use the church to get what we want. Amen. The church age is passing away. We are entering into the kingdom age. Amen, everyone. I can't hear you. I believe, I hear in the spirit, you are echoing the amen. Hallelujah. So we are not to use God, not to use religion, not to use ministry as a platform, whether to fulfill our needs, to promote ourselves. No, but we are to exalt and to glorify God. Amen. So Jabez, because of his that he was being described as more honorable, he pondered deeply and received that understanding. It was all because of sin. That led him to the next thing. When we read the verses just now, I'm sure you are attracted by the phrase, oh, bless me, right? We want to run there very quickly. But let me show you something. The key to the prayer of Jabez is right there after we read about the mother naming him Jabez. In verse 10, look at what did he do. He didn't suddenly start, oh, bless me, Lord. No. Let's read verse 10. And Jabez called on the God of Israel. That was his turning point. After he pondered deeply, after he realized, I'm not to blame my mother, my circumstances, my answer lies only in calling upon the God. You can pray all prayer, but if you are not crying unto God, that's nothing. I've once preached a very simple message from Matthew 11 verse 28, but it caused people to think. You can be singing and thinking that in church or in service, you can be singing but never come to God. You can be praying but never come to God. Isn't that frightening? You can be reading the word of God but never come to God. Otherwise, why did Jesus say in Matthew 11, 28, come to me. We pray and we come to God. We worship, we come to God. Sometimes we do things mechanically, forgetting that we are to come to God. Hallelujah. But all of us here tonight, we come with hunger. We desire more of God. There is such a hunger in your heart. And like Jabez, you are crying out to the God of Israel. Jabez began to call on the God of Israel. Every word in the Bible has a very powerful meaning. Why did Jabez didn't call to the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob? Here it is specifically mentioned to us. He knew God as the God of Israel. And what difference is it to you? You may think, what is this? He was calling to the God who transformed a worm into a prince. My brother, my sister, Jacob called himself a worm. Jacob was known as the supplanter. His hand kept grabbing the leg of his brother. Jacob was known as the supplanter. Grab everything, want to grab. If can grab, will grab. But he ended up as a prince of God. When he encountered God, his name was no longer Jacob. He was now the prince Israel. That's his name. His new name after his encounter at Peniel. And Jabez, he is pain. He knew which God to call to. Not simply any idol that they are worshiping. He's going to cry out to the God of Israel. The God who transformed a worm into a prince. This same God will transform Jabez, who is full, who is carrying pain, who is defined as pain, into someone who has a meaningful destiny in his life. Brothers and sisters, I do not know what is it that troubles your heart. I do not know what you carry in your heart today. But today, the fact that you draw near to God, can I encourage you? God knows every of your need in your heart. He sees what sometimes you also cannot say out to people. You may put on a mask, but way behind the mask is where God wants to meet you. And he is the God that brings transformation from Jacob to Israel. And Jabez called out to the God of Israel. He said, "Oh, that you would bless me indeed. Hallelujah. Oh, Father, that you would bless everyone tonight. Everyone that has gathered in this supernatural encounter. Father, we pray that you will bless each and every one of us. Amen. Hallelujah." But let's, as we have learned from Jabez, let's sink deeper, okay? Let's sink deeper. Don't be so quick to jump the gun. We have been far too long in this bless me culture. What was Jabez praying? Could it be that he was already in all this pain, and when he called up to God, "Oh, that you would bless me," do you think he was asking for a chariot, a new chariot? Do you think that would change his destiny? So wait a minute, let's sink deeper. Do you think chariot means car? That day, in his times, there was no car. Was he praying for a car? Was he praying for a house? Was that what blessing mean? Could Jabez be praying for more money? Would more money relieve him of the pain that is in his heart, in his spirit? Would money be the answer? We're gonna sink deeper tonight, brother and sister. We're going to align ourselves. We're going to position ourselves to receive his blessing. Amen. If you followed me just now, when Jabez began to recall the first instance of a woman feeling pain was when God pronounced a curse on Eve. If you remember clearly, during creation, before Adam and Eve fell, there was no curse at all. Everything that God created, God blessed. Remember that? Including man. Everything that God created, he blessed them. He said, "Be fruitful and multiply." Does this tell you where Jabez had the inspiration to pray? So sometimes we pray many things, but when we learn to be still, when we learn to think deeply, allow the Holy Spirit to whisper to us, he can even teach us what to pray, how to pray the prayer that God will answer. Surely the Holy Spirit inspired prayer will be answered by God. Hallelujah. So he began to recall, no curse before the pain. It was all blessing. All the time, God only blessed. Therefore, he began to ask for a restoration of God's original plan, God's original heart. When God created man and woman, it was never, never, never to cause pain, never ever to cause suffering. All the suffering, pain, darkness, and uncertainty in this life, in this world, is because of man's sin. It's not because of God. God has always created all his creation and he blessed them. Amen. So when we look at this phrase, "Oh, that you would bless me," let's look at it from a full counsel. I wouldn't say full, but let's look at it from a full biblical context. Far too often, we take this verse, we run with it. We go everywhere, "God bless me. You know, God bless me. Me with money and all." We begin to think that blessing is just limited to money. And then we miss what God really wants to bless us with. Like I said, do you think Jabez was asking for a new chariot? Obviously not. He was in pain. He was asking for something more. Let me show you a verse that Jesus said. All of you would have known this verse, but let's be reminded of this verse in Matthew chapter 6. Have you
Memorize this, Matthew 6:25. Therefore, I say to you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat, what you will drink, nor about your body, what you will put on. Is not life more than food and the body more than clothing? What has Jesus just said to us? We don't even have to worry about food. We don't even have to worry about drink, what to eat, what to drink, what to wear. Which tells me, when I pray, Lord, bless me, all that He has taken care of. The food, the drink, our clothing, our necessities, our needs, our basic needs. He's a good Father. Brothers and sisters, we have a Father. Our God is a Father who loves us very much. He will not despise you. He will not forsake you. He will not leave you. And He said, don't worry about these things. My Father cares for you for all these things. So that's already one clue that blessing is not just talking about all these physical necessities. But let's be balanced. Let's look at another verse in the Old Testament. Let's look at Proverbs. Proverbs chapter 10, verse 22. Wow, this is a wonderful verse that we should all memorize. I'm sure many of you have grabbed this promise. It says here, the blessing of the Lord. Everybody shout it loud. A blessing of the Lord makes one rich, and He adds no sorrow with it. Hallelujah. Blessings of God will make you rich, my brother, my sister. Again, please don't see the dollar sign in my eyes. Riches are not just limited to money. Amen. Hallelujah. We're going to see deeper. That's why let's have a better overview. What was God, what was Jabez praying when he said, oh, that you would bless me? Jesus already said He will provide for us our basic needs. Here, the proverb, the wise author of Proverbs tells me, the blessing of the Lord will make me rich. But don't miss the second part. Many rich people have a lot of sorrow. I cannot say those are God's blessing. I'm sorry. According to the definition of the Bible here, it says that the riches that is given by God will have no sorrow added to it. Say amen. Hallelujah. Those of you who are in the business, God bless your business. He will enrich your business, but He will not add sorrow to it. Amen. Hallelujah. Then let's look. I'm going to show you another verse. I'm just going to show you this one or two more verses and we are done. Luke 16. Luke 16 verses 10 to 12. He who is faithful in what is least is faithful also in much. He who is unjust in what is least is unjust also in much. Verse 11. Follow me. Therefore, if you have not been faithful in the unrighteous mammon, who will commit to your trust the true riches? And if you have not been faithful in another man's, who will give you what is your own? The comparison is, you must first be faithful with the least. And here we are told very clearly, monetary riches is the least, right? It is being compared. There are true riches in God. So when He says the blessing of the Lord makes us rich, yes, money is one of them, but it's the least. In the whole list, it ranks the lowest. It's the least. We got to learn to be faithful with that. Only then God can entrust us with, what is the word used there? True riches. It is the least riches here, but we want, God wants to bless us, the blessing that will add true riches to your life, to my life. So with these few verses, we can begin to form a clearer understanding what does biblical blessing is. I mean, when Jabez prayed, oh, that you would bless me, what did he have in his mind? What was he thinking? First of all, brothers and sisters, please note this. Biblical blessing is never
based on circumstances. I repeat, get this into your spirit. Biblical blessing is not based on circumstances. It is no respective of circumstances. Whatever the circumstances, God can still bless you. And whatever the circumstances is not the correct measurement of whether you are blessed or not. Why do I say so? Think about Apostle Paul. He suffered pain. He suffered stoning. He suffered beating. He suffered hunger. Oops. This is the Apostle Paul. We've been reading all the epistles he's been writing. This is the Apostle Paul. In 2 Corinthians 11, you can see the list of what he has gone through. Hunger, thirst, cold. Who are we talking about here? The apostle of apostles. The question to ask here, let's put a comma here. Isn't he a blessed man? Wasn't Apostle Paul a blessed man? So my brother and sister, as we begin to meditate deeper, when God bless you and me, even though the circumstances is as bad as the world can get, you can remain the most blessed person on this planet Earth. You and I must begin to position ourselves to receive, to remain, to be in this position of blessing. God is raising up a generation that experiences, that lives out this blessing in the midst of difficulty, in the midst of famine, in the midst of tribulation. We can no longer wait for the good times to roll until we are blessed, because biblical blessing is not dependent on circumstances. Number two, biblical blessing has nothing to do with what you have or what you don't have. What you have, what you don't have, is not a measurement of God's blessing. When Jesus needed a coin to pay the tax, he told his disciple, go and fish. Brothers and sisters, that is true riches, that is blessing. There is no lack. When I need to pay, go and fish. In the mouth of the fish, you will have the coin to pay the tax. That's the supernatural kingdom God has called you and me to live. We've got to begin to have a shift of paradigm in our mindset. We got to shift to kingdom mindset. Amen. Hallelujah. This is also for hallelujah. Don't worry. What we are listening today is also a blessing for you if you have not known Jesus yet. Jesus is the answer to the darkness, to the uncertainty, to all that you are going through. The story I'm telling you is a person who knows God, who prays, and he found his breakthrough. Tonight, if you continue to stay on, just keep on listening to me. I'm going to end shortly. This message will bless you, will position you. You will have an opportunity to know the one and only true God, that through Jesus Christ, because he died for your sin and my sin, we can triumph even in the midst of darkness. Amen. When I say amen, means I agree with all my heart. Hallelujah. So that is true riches. True riches, my friend, whether you are Christian, you are not Christian, is something good that you can learn today. True riches is not what you have, what you don't have. It's not dependent on the circumstances. True riches is when you have God on your side. Hallelujah. True riches is not for show one. You know, many times we want things, we want this, we want that, we want this blessing. It's for show. Blessing is not for you to show. But when you have true blessing, blessing is when you have God's favor, God, divine favor, different from what man can give you. This is the highest level. When God is with you, when he supports you, you don't need other people to give you any support letter. When he support you, when he encourage you, when he is in partnership with you, that is God's blessing for you. Amen. And Jabez, when he pray, oh God, that you would bless me. Now is a good time for all of us to ask for God's blessing. You know, in Chinese New Year, Chinese also believe in blessing. Everything, every culture believes in blessing, not just in one race. Every race, every human is born with the capacity to long to be blessed, not by just men, but by someone more powerful, more higher than me, and that is God. In the Bible is the word of God. It is inspired by God. So in the Bible, we are told there are curses, there are blessings. And it is very clear in Deuteronomy chapter 28. Jesus did not come and do away with the Old Testament. He came to fulfill it. So he said, obedience. Obedience doesn't qualify you for blessing. No, it's the blood of Jesus. It's the grace of God. But obedience positions you to receive blessing from God. When Jabez was praying, oh, that you would bless me. Oh, God, please bless me. He was positioning himself. He was making choices. He was aligning his lifestyle to begin to have a lifestyle of obedience. If you don't want the Old Testament, look at the New Testament in Matthew chapter 5. When Jesus came to this earth, he showed us what heaven is like. He said, you want to know true blessing? He begins to tell the people in Matthew chapter 5. He begins to tell, this is how the kingdom of God looks like. When you are poor in your spirit, you are blessed. What was Jesus saying? When you are so hungry for things in your heart, you're longing for God, you will find blessing because you will find God. When you hunger and thirst for righteousness, Jesus said, you will be blessed. So when we pray, God bless me, we got to position ourselves to have a lifestyle of obedience, to begin to position ourselves to have hunger, to be merciful, to have a pure heart. So more than just a prayer, Jabez was positioning himself. I want to receive God's best in my life. Not just money, there can be more things. God can bless you in your health. God can bless you in your relationship. God can bless you in what you do. And your life can be full of meaning. In the midst of a pandemic, in the midst of uncertain times, you can have a blessed life because it does not depend on what goes on around you. When God chooses to bless you, you are blessed. Amen. The second thing that Jabez prayed, for those who have just joined, we are meditating very quickly on the prayer of Jabez. Just stay with me. At the end of this prayer, at the end of this sharing, I will pray with you. We ask Jesus to come and encounter you. You will have a blessing in your life. So the second thing that Jabez prayed was, enlarge my territory. He was asking God to enlarge his territory. If we know the Bible, if we have read the Old Testament story before, when God brought his people to the promised land, God has already allotted for every tribe. There are 12 tribes of Israel. He said, this tribe, you take this land. This tribe, you take this land. So when equipped with this knowledge, when we read this, enlarge my territory, God is not saying, this which I give you, I will enlarge it. No. Let's understand it further. What Jabez was praying is, God, show me in this life what you have given me to do. Many people in this life, they don't know what to do. They do this and then they feel emptiness in their lives. Am I supposed to be doing this or am I something? God has a destiny for everyone. Christians, non-Christians, God has a destiny for you. And only God can show what is that destiny to you. You and I do not know. That is why Jabez prayed, enlarge my territory. When he prayed like that, he was saying, God, please show me. When I know, when I start to do what you show me, you will increase my territory. Means you will grow what I will be doing correctly. That will give me full satisfaction. Increase it. Enlarge it, increase my influence, let it grow. That is what Jabez means. Because we have to look at the Bible as a whole. Remember the parable of talent? When the master gave, I give you 3 talents. I give you talents means maybe I give you something, a gift, a present. I give you 3 present, 2 present, 1 present. Later I come back, I want to see how do you deal with it. So those who didn't do anything, the master say, you're wicked, you're lazy. But those who are faithful, from two, he got two. The master say, I will take those who are lazy and wicked and give it to you. So in other words, when we pray, enlarge my territory, Jabez was saying, God, you can count me to be a faithful person. Please show me what you want me to do in this life. When you show me, I will do it with all my heart. I will do it with a sincere heart. I will be faithful. You can count me as a faithful person. And when I keep doing this, help me increase it. Let it grow. Let it have meaning. Let it influence others so that other people will also find meaning in their lives. Please imagine with me. Some people, they always pray, oh, please enlarge my business. Oh, give up, enlarge my influence. God is someone who can see the end from the beginning. If he knows that he increases your business and influence and you are not ready, after your business grow, then you begin to be funny. We splurge money in everything to find pleasure and we get ourselves into all trouble. So if God has already seen the future, he knows the end from the beginning, do you think as a wise God, as a wise parent, will a parent give a car key to a 10-year-old child? He or she is not ready yet, right? So in essence, let's go another level. What Jabez was praying is, brother and sister, my friends, if you are here tonight, listen to me. When he was praying, enlarge my territory, Jabez was saying, increase my inner capacity for you. When inside you can bear it, you are ready for greater influence. You can ask for greater business, greater influence. But God sees, hey, you're not ready, lah. You're like the 10-year-old child. I give you this car, you will knock down a lot of people. You know, God sees that. So the way to pray, how do we position ourselves? We are asking God, God, bless me. Position me. I'm ready to be blessed. Enlarge my capacity inside. Am I ready for greater blessing? Am I ready for an increase in what I do? If you are in a ministry, if you are helping people in your business, in your work, are you ready for an increase? Inside first. Jabez knew that. He said, enlarge my territory. In his heart, he said, God, make my heart big enough to be able to sustain this, to be able to receive this blessing that I'm asking. Let's go on. The next thing that Jabez prayed, Jabez is the man we are looking at in the Bible. He prayed, his name is Jabez. It means pain. He prayed, your hand would be with me. You will keep me from evil that I may not cause pain. Let's look at this together. He said that God's hand will be with him, that God will keep him from evil. He knew that evil, when he has evil in his heart, it will cause pain in his life. Like what I said, the reason why men suffer, why in our lives, why human being has suffering is not because God wants to cause us to suffer. It's sin. Everyone is born into this world with sin. No one can deal with the sin problem except through the blood of Jesus. Jesus came down as a man who has never committed sin. He took your place. He took my place. He died on the cross as a perfect human being. And the blood that was shed from his body, they killed him as an innocent criminal. All the four people that they brought him to, they asked, is he guilty? Four people said, not guilty. And he died as a person who did not commit any sin. The blood that was shed from his body, that's the only thing in this world that can wash your sin, that can break the curse in your life, that can stop evil from disturbing you, that can stop evil from causing pain in your life. We are told in the Bible, because he died on the cross, our sickness can be healed. By his stripe, he will suffer a lot of beating, all the beating that he endured, so that you and me can receive healing. We can be All the curses in our life can be broken all through the blood of Jesus. From pain, God can transform our life to one that is full of joy, peace, and love, and full of meaning. So this is what Jabez prayed. Let your hand protect me, and you keep me from evil so that I will not cause pain anymore. So like every businessman or every entrepreneur or everybody, they know with increased influence, when your business grows, more problems. You have more responsibilities, more problems. And if from the spiritual aspect, more attacks, more dangers, right? When things begin to grow, we ask God, increase, let enlarge my territory. But Jabez is a wise person. He thinks, Holy Spirit teaches him how to pray. When God enlarges your territory, when God expands your influence, you must have his protection. His hand must continue to shield you. His hand must continue to be that wall of fire around you. With increased temptation, with increased responsibility comes increased temptation. Remember what I say, this is true. We all must learn, this is human nature. When we have increased responsibility, there will be increased temptation. Therefore, we need God even more. It's not that God we only need one time. We need Jesus all the time. He protects us all the time. We keep depending on him. God, hold my hand. He will never let go. Once he holds your hand, it is us who let go. We see other things we want to hold. But if we hold his, we keep on holding his hand, he will protect us. His favor will continue to be with us. People will get jealous. People will be envious. People will begin to say bad things about you, say bad things behind you. All these things are bound to happen. But if you react in the flesh, you and I will go back to the cycle of causing pain in our lives. We scold them back. How can he say like that to me? Last time I helped him, now he do this to me, right? Well, now because I'm my business, now because increase in influence, now he say like that to me. Then you begin to curse people. And what happens next? When we do all that, we sow all this, we begin to reap again. We are back into the cycle of pain. Jabez, led by the Spirit of God, he prayed, God, when you bless me, when I begin to grow, when I know your blessing in my life, please, please help me guard my heart. Protect my heart. When people begin to be envious, when people say bad things, when people betray me, when I'm promoted, and when people is not happy and say evil things about me, Lord, guard my heart, guard my mouth, guard my mind. May your hand be with me. Keep my mouth from evil. Keep my mind from thinking evil. Keep my heart from responding in evil. All these things will only cause me to go into a cycle of pain again and again. Then you feel guilty. Then we end up in much misery. So brother and sister, tonight we look at this prayer of Jabez in 2021 in a deeper layer. We begin to appreciate human nature, and we begin to pray as how God teaches us to pray. Not just for external things, but begin to prepare what is inside. Begin to address the needs inside. Our true human needs are in the inside. All the external needs, God promised he will take care, he will provide. But the inside needs, we got to cooperate and partner with him. We got to have a relationship with him. We got to talk to him. God, I'm so tempted to scold that fella. Really, when I cannot talk to him about your anger, talk to him, God, I want to commit revenge. If you, please help me. Please give me wisdom to deal with this matter. You got to talk. We have a God. God is the perfect counselor. When you have no one to talk to God. And he promised to talk, to hear us and to answer us. Instead of go and search Mr. Google, go and ask for this, ask for that, you have a God who can give you the best answer. Tell him, Lord, cannot. I will do this, I will do that, I will react like that. Like Jabez, God, keep my heart. Don't let me fall into this habitual way of reacting. God will become your faithful friend. God will be your BFF, your best friend forever. But you don't become best friend forever suddenly. We take time to develop friendship. Tonight, for some of you who have never received Jesus, this is your first step to make Jesus your best friend. It is your lifelong journey to get to know this friend who will never turn his back on you, never betray you. He will never hurt you. I can assure you, he will never leave you alone. He's the perfect friend. But don't stop at just receiving him. Begin to develop, cultivate friendship. Spend time. Have tea time with him. Drink with him. Have tea time and drink with him. Enjoy his company. And begin to see he's real. He begins to protect you inside out. He begins to bless you inside out. He begins to increase your influence inside out. Amen. As we position ourselves, as you have been listening to me in the past 30, 40 minutes, what you listen, if you hear it, if you capture it inside, you are beginning to align yourself. You say, yes, yes, Lord, yes, Lord. In the past, I just do things, I just take things, I take advantage of you. I make use of you. But today, I'm aligning myself back. It's not about all that. I'm now aligning myself back to you, Lord. Amen. So that when we begin to understand all these things that Jabez prayed, his life was never the same again. His life was worth mentioning in the Bible so that, you see, from a life of temporal pain, his name was Pain. People call him Pain. His mother gave him the name Pain. Because of a temporary pain, he learned to seek God. He encountered God. His life turned and have an eternal meaning. Why do I say eternal meaning? His life now is recorded in the Bible. His life is now has an eternal value. Wow. From a cursed life, from a life of darkness and pain, now becomes a life of meaning, blessing, of eternal value. Not just die already, no meaning. Until today, his life is still speaking to you and to me. His life was more than 3,000 years ago. But it's still talking to you. It's still talking to me. And like what in the last part that we learned just now, in the last part of the two verses we read in 1 Chronicles, what is the beautiful thing about the prayer of Jabez? God granted him what he requested. Tonight, if you have learned to align yourself, it takes a daily thing. Tonight, we decide to align ourselves. Tomorrow, we continue to align ourselves. We continue to see the increase of God's answer to our prayer. Amen. He said, God granted him what he requested. When I read this, it is similar to what Jesus said, right? What we read in the gospel. Whoever prays in my name, whatever you ask in my name, it shall be given to you, right? It shall be, your request will be granted. How many of you tried in Jesus' name, it will happen? Do you think it works like that? In Hebrew, the word name, like I told you, Jabez is a name of a man. In Hebrew, the word name always signifies character and authority. When we pray in the character of Jesus, in the authority of Jesus, your answer will be great. Amen. Amen. When you pray in the character, the ones that we have gone through, Jabez, all the things that he prayed reflect the character and the authority of Jesus. So my brother and my sister, you can encounter the heart of the Father tonight when you realize how much he loves you, how much He cares for each one of you. And the key to encountering Him, to receiving His blessing, is when we begin to align ourselves with God's nature. We align ourselves with His character. We align ourselves with His authority. You can do that. If you have not received Jesus before, tonight will be your first day of your adventure with Jesus. If you have received Jesus as your Lord and Savior, tonight may God bring you to another level as you align yourself, as you begin to think deeper, ponder deeper in the things that happen in your life. It's not so much on the surface. Allow God to speak to your heart. Allow God to change, to transform our hearts. Amen. Hallelujah. Jabez prayed, God, You would bless me. We have seen what that means. God, enlarge my territory. We have briefly looked at that. God, that Your hand will be with me. You will keep me from evil, that I may not cause pain, that I will not go back to sin that has always caused me pain. And God granted him what he requested. Tonight, this is your portion, my brother and sister. We are going to enter into a time of prayer together. I think, I'm not sure if I'm, if we are going to enter into this, go straight away, we enter into a time of prayer, or we'll, if, let Brother Davey to say something. Do you want to go straight to the time of prayer and ministry?
Yes. You can pray, and then probably those who are need prayer, we can ask them to leave the prayer request in the chat group. If it's very personal, then they can leave a phone number, then we can call them back. And so then it's more orderly. So if you really need a prayer, leave the prayer request on the chat group. But I will initially probably can make a corporate prayer for everybody. Yeah.
Okay, praise the Lord. I pray that the word that has been shared is a blessing to all of you, that it speaks to you in different areas of your life. We're going to enter into a time of prayer and ministry. If you have never received Jesus before, and in your heart you feel that I want Jesus in my life, you can also type that in the chat group. Someone will lead you to believe and receive Jesus as your Lord and Savior. It's a most important decision that you make in your life. Made that decision. Many people in this meeting tonight has made that decision, and it is the time to make this decision. So if this is your decision, you can quickly do that. You can type in your desire to receive Jesus as your Lord and Savior. Okay, and then we're going to pray together. And right now, we're going to invite the Holy Spirit in our midst. Holy Spirit is God, and we're going to pray and ask Holy Spirit to move in our midst. I do not know what are your needs, but God knows all your needs. And what we have heard tonight, He will come and He will touch you. He will touch your life. And I do not know if Brother Yesudas, you want to play a music or something. If that's fine, if not, it's fine. But we're just gonna close our eyes. We're gonna focus on God. We're gonna allow the Holy Spirit to touch you. So wherever you are, just don't leave. Just concentrate, open up your heart to God. What God has shared with you tonight through the word of God is your portion. You got to grab hold of it. Like what I've said just now, you want God to pour blessings in your life? Let's begin to align our lives to Him in order to receive from Him. So brothers and sisters, wherever you are, begin to open your heart. What does opening your heart mean? Begin to talk to Him. Say, Lord, bless me. Or perhaps what you have heard tonight, you begin to feel that God is speaking to you. You can begin to say, God, I'm sorry. I want to change in this area of my life. I want to change in the area of my thoughts, in how I say things, in how I react to things. This is a very sacred moment, very important moment. This is the time when your life has a turning point, has a breakthrough, when you begin to be truthful to God. You don't need to tell me, but as at this moment, very important moment, if you hear background music, as Brother Yesu does play something, you begin to engage God. Engage means you tell God honestly, God, I need you. I need a healing touch from you tonight. I need a prophetic touch from you tonight. I need your hand to be on me. How you change Jabez's life, I want that in my life. How you make Jacob into Israel, I want that in my life. If this is your desire, if this is your prayer, just lift up your hands wherever you are.